Blessed be the one, holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have so linked our lives one with another that all we do affects, for good or ill, all other lives. So guide us in the work we do, that we may do it not for self alone, but for the common good. And as we seek a proper return for our own labor, make us mindful of the rightful aspirations of other workers and arouse our concern for those who are out of work. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" He said, "I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." He said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among thy peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. No. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Send your Spirit, God, to open our hearts and our minds to your word and strengthen us to live according to your will. In Jesus' name. Over the course of my working life in the church, I have had the opportunity of knowing some wonderful people. One of them was my friend, the late Bishop George Barrett. George was a great leader on justice issues and the church, and he once told me the story of being interviewed on television when he was Bishop of Rochester, New York. This was in TV's early days when guests were asked to wear lavalier microphones around their necks. During a commercial break, the sound technician came to adjust his microphone. It was banging up against the large pectoral cross that bishops wear on their chest. The technician said, "The problem is the cross. It's causing interference." George Barrett looked up at him and said, "It always does." The cross causes interference. In this morning's gospel, Jesus tells his companions that the journey they are on will end with his death on the cross at the hands of the Roman Empire. Peter cannot abide this. "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." Those who follow Jesus have not reckoned on the reality of the cross as part of the transaction. Jesus knows that his critique of the empire and the religious system that colludes with it will result in his being brought to a political prisoner's death on the cross. Those who accompany Jesus think that following him will be about sitting at his feet and copying down his pithy sayings. But Jesus knows that following him means being called into a life at odds with the forces of empire, a conflict that will result for many of his followers in persecution and martyrdom and death. The problem is the cross. It's causing interference. It always does. After he rebukes Peter, Jesus says these memorable words, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life?" To be a Christian, to live under the sign of the cross, is to be a perpetual voice for interference. It means that we will always bring the gospel's values to bear upon social and ethical and cultural problems. Because the imperial presumptions with which we are called to interfere are always centered on power, the gospel critique of those presumptions will always promote the voices and concerns of the powerless. In Jesus' day and in ours, the consequences of that cultural critique will not always be pretty. The cross will always cause interference, because in signing on to be followers of Jesus, we are signing on to be fellow travelers with him on the way of the cross. And while walking that way with Jesus promises ultimate joy and final peace, in the near term, it often delivers suffering and loss. Jesus' insistence on the way of the cross is, as the way of life is, for us first world privileged Christians, profoundly countercultural. The message our culture sends us repeatedly is a message of grasping after something. You preserve your life by beating out the other guy. For Jesus and his followers, you preserve your life by what the theologian Sally McFaig calls cruciform living. The philosopher Aristotle posed life's basic question: how then shall we live? Many today ask Aristotle's question. They ask it about our wider society. They ask it about their own individual lives. One of my favorite theological reflections on how to live is Sally McFaig's book, Life Abundant. And here, in part, is what she says. She says, "We cannot in good conscience love the world, its snow-capped mountains and panda bears, while at the same time destroying it and allowing our less well-off sisters and brothers to sink into deeper poverty. Hence," she says, "I believe Christian discipleship for 21st North American Christians means cruciform living, an alternative notion of the abundant life which will involve a philosophy of enoughness, limitations on energy use, and sacrifice for the sake of others." She concludes, "For us privileged Christians, a cross-shaped life will not be primarily what Christ does for us, but what we can do for others." What she calls a philosophy of enoughness, though, is a hard bargain for the likes of you and me. Speaking only for myself, in relation to things, I am like a morbidly obese person who no longer knows when he is full. I do not have trustworthy judgment when it comes to knowing how much is enough. And I'm a person who reads the Bible and goes to church every day. So if we Christians don't even know what is enough, imagine how hard it is for the others in our culture who have been led to believe that one is satisfied only when one is stuffed. When Jesus tells us this morning to deny ourselves, to take up our cross, and to follow him, our first response is always to think about sacrifice and martyrdom. But starting from our place of relative affluence, perhaps the first image of self-denial might lie in what Sally McFaig calls enoughness. Can I live trying to regain a trustworthy sense of what is really enough? Enough food, enough money, enough energy use, enough houses and cars and the like? For us first world Christians, taking up the cross begins in a diagnosis that we already have enough. Jesus lived an abundant life in the midst of deprivation, and he called others to share that life. So cruciform living means walking in such a generosity of spirit and such a generosity of practice that allows the underlying abundance of God's creation to shine through us. Denying ourselves, taking up our cross, and following Jesus begins when we realize that we already have enough. But following Jesus does not end there. Speaking as a native Californian, I know how easy it is to fall into the self-satisfied smugness of the so-called sustainable lifestyle. Hey, I'm driving a hybrid. I'm eating locally sourced food. And I'm composting. I'm saving the planet. When you live in beautiful, expensive surroundings, it is easy to feel virtuous by paying a little bit more for environmentally friendly luxuries that poor people can't afford in the first place. 2 years ago, Kathy and I moved here to Washington from Detroit. And if you follow the news, you know how many economic and social challenges that city faces today. Another of my favorite contemporary writers, a woman named Rebecca Solnit, has visited Detroit, and she has written thoughtfully about what the change there might mean for all of us in post-industrial America. In her writing, Rebecca Solnit describes both the industrial deterioration of Detroit and the surprising rebirth of local agriculture in the vacant blocks of open land left by the razed and burnt out buildings. Here is one of the more provocative things that she observes as she watches the painful but also inspiring way in which new life can follow economic devastation. She says, "The free-range chickens and the Priuses are great, but they alone aren't adequate tools for creating a truly different society and ecology. The future, at least the sustainable one, the one in which we will survive, isn't going to be invented by people who are happily surrendering selective bits and pieces of environmentally unsound privilege. It's going to be made by those who had all that taken away from them or who never had it in the first place." In other words, if you and I are really talking about cruciform living, then as a friend of mine observes, something has to die before this rebirth can begin. That something is obviously the exploitive consumerist fantasy in which all of us live and move and have our being. Detroit is coming to life precisely because it exhibits what Rebecca Solnit calls the first signs of an unsettling of the very premises of colonial expansion. As she says, we cannot live out the logic of the cross only by happily surrendering selective bits and pieces of environmentally unsound privilege. So our walking the way of the cross as Christians must point us beyond self-congratulatory abstinence. We walk the way of the cross not only as individuals, we do so as a community. Only as we Christians witness separately and together to a truly sacrificial and communitarian and abundant way of living can we be truly said to be living a cruciform life. Bishop Barrett was right. The cross will always cause interference. It will get in the way of our culture's shallow vision of the abundant life. It will continue to frustrate our fantasies of our own virtue. We will join God in making God's future as we walk the way of the cross with those who had privilege taken away from them or never had it in the first place. We will save our lives by losing them in community with those who know what real deprivation looks and feels like. May the one who walked the way of the cross with his companions then walk with us now in our strivings toward cruciform living. May that one sustain us to accept that we really do have enough. May that one bring us all together across the social and racial and economic boundaries that divide us in common purpose to the end that God's creatures may know the true abundance of the life lived together on the way of the cross. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God of our parents and our ancestors, God of our Lord Jesus Christ, we call to you from very kind of misery and oppression. You hear and heed our cry. To your people in bondage, you send Moses. Nerve him with your name, intimate, strong, precious. By the cross, Jesus reveals the depth of your redeeming love for all who put their trust in you. We pray for our sick and suffering world. Holy God, strengthen all who minister in the name of Jesus and grant that Christ may be revealed in the life and witness of your holy church. Holy God, guide and make wise in faith, learning, and governance the leaders of every land. Make them bold and willing to meet our many and great challenges with integrity and courage. Holy God,
this is our prayer.
awaken us to the groans of your creation and make us partners in your unending desire to renew the face of the earth. Holy God, mindful of the many who struggle to feed their families, deepen our understanding of labor this day. In the economy of your love, challenge us to labor not only for ourselves, but for the common good, that all may earn and eat. Holy God, tenderly sustain the sick and the needy, those in any kind of trouble, fear, or doubt, those who suffer any kind of adversity, those who are alone. Holy God, give comfort to those who mourn, draw near to the dying, and receive them with your heavenly grace into the company of all who have died in faith. Holy God,
deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Lord, we would prefer an easier assignment. Give us strength to follow where you lead, an unflinching desire to embrace your call upon our lives. Give us courage to hold fast to what is good and stamina to resist evil. Free us to offer ourselves and our lives for the sake of the world you love and came to serve. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Let us confess to God the sins and shortcomings of the world, our share in what is wrong, and our failure to seek that which God wills for all God's children. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done what is evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. To crown all things, there must be love. To bind all together and complete the whole. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord.
Peace be with you.
Okay.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your Spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being, sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels and the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Honor and praise to you, holy and living God. To deliver us from the power of sin and death, and to reveal the riches of your grace, you looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ, crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves, a living sacrifice. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. in the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Jesus Christ, and with Jesus Christ, and in Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say, each in our own language, the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. In the name of God and this cathedral church, we send you forth bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you may go share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body, because we all share one cup. Let us pray. Lord of all mercy, we, your faithful people, have celebrated that one true sacrifice which takes away our sins and brings pardon and peace. By our communion, keep us firm on the foundation of the gospel and preserve us from all sin. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May Christ, who makes saints of sinners, raise and strengthen you, that you may transform the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.